Hello friends, welcome to video series on geography. My name is Manjunath and this is my blog. You can find all the text files in this blog. In my previous video, I've explained about the universe and solar system. In this video, I'll begin with the interior of the earth or internal structure of the earth. From here, we'll see the core concepts of geomorphology. So all these concepts are important both for prelims as well as mains. In this video, I'll be explaining about earthquake waves, which are the important source that help us understand the Earth's internal structure, and then we'll see physical and chemical properties of different layers of Earth. So, Earth is made up of concentric layers with varying physical and chemical properties, and based on these physical and chemical properties, they are divided into crust, which is the outermost layer, followed by mantle, and then outer core and inner core. Each of these layers have their own properties. We'll study them in detail. So in this video, I'll be explaining why one has to know about Earth's interior. When I say one, it simply means why scientists are struggling to know about Earth's interior. And then we'll see what are the sources of information about the Earth's interior. And then we'll discuss the most important source, that is the seismic waves or earthquake waves. And based on all these, we will have an understanding about Earth's interior, and then we'll discuss about layers of Earth, that is crust, mantle and core. We'll study them in detail. So why know about Earth's interior? There are various processes happening both above the surface as well as within the surface of Earth, and these processes are divided into exogenic and endogenic processes. Exogenic or exogenetic processes are the ones which happen on the surface, whereas endogenetic are the ones which happen within the surface. So all these processes mainly have their origin or forces that come from deep inside the earth. For example, let us take an exogenic process like volcano, and the energy for a volcanic eruption comes from deep inside. And again, let us consider an endogenic process like earthquake. Earthquake happens within the Earth's surface or below the Earth's surface. And the force for earthquake also comes from deep inside the Earth. And thus, it becomes important for us to understand these geophysical phenomena which are totally based on the internal forces that are originating from the Earth's interior. So, it becomes important for us to study about Earth's interior to understand not just earthquakes and volcanoes, various other processes like mountain building process, and to understand the whole geomorphology of the Earth's surface, etc. And then to understand the internal structure of solar system objects. We know that all the solar system objects were born from the same nebula or the dust of gas, cloud of dust and gases. And the processes involved in their formation are same. So by understanding Earth's internal structure, it will be of great help to understand other internal structure of other planets and other solar system objects. And then atmosphere is a direct result of volcanism. The present constitution of atmosphere is mainly due to volcanic eruptions that took place about few billion years ago and even influenced now also. So to understand the composition of the atmosphere, it is important that we know about the Earth's interior. So it will help us in understanding both evolution as well as present changes in atmosphere. And then coming to deep sea mining and deep earth mining, we know that the minerals on surface are fast exhausting. In future, we will have to venture or explore minerals below the ocean surface or deep inside the crust. And even for successful or economically viable way of exploring these minerals is only possible with having a good understanding about Earth's interior. Then what are the sources of information about the interior? There are basically two kinds of sources. One are direct sources and the other one are indirect sources. Basically, all the direct sources like deep earth mining as well as volcanic eruptions tell us that Earth's interior is very hot and it is at great pressures. And the indirect sources like gravitation, magnetic field and meteors give us more detail about Earth's interior. Gravitation also more or less tells about how gravity influences pressure with increase in depth. We know that Earth is circular in shape and the gravitation pull is towards center. So one can understand what amount of pressure would be at a certain point based on gravitation and other physical understanding. And magnetic field is a direct resultant of Earth's layers where there is convection cycles happening. For example, within mantle core there are convection cycles or the convection of hot magma, and this convection of hot magma along with the Coriolis force give rise to a concept called as geodynamo, or the production of magnetic field. So we know that Earth's magnetic field is very important in protecting its atmosphere. We have seen how solar wind is blocked by this Earth's magnetosphere or magnetic field. So it is important that we understand how is this magnetic field or is originating and what are the changes happening within the magnetic field. And for this we need to know about Earth's internal structure, as the magnetic field is a direct resultant of the convection or spiraling effect of magma that is happening deep in the inside the Earth's crust. And again, gravity, as we have seen, gravity mainly is a resultant of the mass. So when there is more mass, the gravitation field above the surface will be greater, and when there is less mass, the gravitation field will be lower. This is because gravitation is a direct resultant of mass. So we can see in places like trenching, that is where a plate subducts below one, there is formation of trench where the mass of Earth is low. At these places the gravitation is usually low, and this is called as gravitational anomaly. So by understanding the changes in gravitation, one can say what is the nature of layers within the Earth's interior. But this source is of not that great significance, and it will give only a few details about Earth's interior. And meteors are very important sources, we'll see them in detail. So we know that all the solar system objects were formed with the same physical processes, where we have seen nebula theory of Laplace, how all the planets were born, and we have seen how they are revolving around the sun, and how the inner cores are formed during the initial phases. So most of the heavy metals are concentrated at the core, at the center. So at the core there is some radioactivity happening, or there can be some radioactivity or left out heat after the formation of solar system that is present at the center. So this heat generates a very hot internal structures, as well as the denser materials being at the center increases the density of the core. From this we can say that all the objects or solar system objects have the same kind of origin and same kind of structure. And when we see meteors are nothing but the debris from asteroid belt. We have discussed this thing in previous video. So when these meteors enter the Earth's atmosphere, they get burnt due to the friction. But when a meteor is of significant size, it can escape the Earth's atmosphere and fall on Earth. So when a meteor reaches Earth, by studying the rocks, we'll see that the density of such rocks which are left out are very high. This is because the outer layers are burnt, whereas the inner core falls to the Earth, and this core is so dense, which signifies that all solar system objects have a very dense core. So the most important explanation comes from seismic waves. Seismic waves are also called as earthquake waves. There are three kinds of earthquake waves, namely primary, secondary and surface waves. We'll see them in detail later. But for now, earthquake mainly happens due to faulting of a block of Earth. So what is a fault? Faulting is sudden slipping off a section of Earth, which leads to the generation of earthquake waves. And the point where earthquake waves originate is called as focus. And the point exactly above the focus on the Earth's surface is called as epicenter. The intensity of earthquake waves is greatest at the epicenter than on any other part of the Earth's surface. This is because of the shortest distance between the focus and the epicenter. So the maximum destruction occurs at epicenter. So there are mainly three kinds of faults. One is normal fault, then reverse fault, and there's something called as transcurrent fault. In normal fault, usually a block of Earth slips towards the center of the Earth. This mainly happens due to the separation of blocks surrounding it, where the two blocks let the other blocks slip between them. and this is called as normal faulting. And then in the other kind of fault, the pressure applied by two blocks will uplift the block in between them, and in such a case the fault formed is called as reverse fault, where the block of earth moves away from the center of the earth, that is towards, that is it moves upwards. And then in transcurrent fault, there is no downward or upward movement of blocks, but only horizontal movement. One good example for transcurrent fault is the San Andreas Fault in USA. It is this small piece of California. We know that USA and then a small extension of California, which is a part of San Andreas Fault. Usually this is a part of Pacific Ocean, whereas the remaining mainland, USA, is a part of North American plate. So there is a fault line between them where earthquakes took place in the past, and they were severe. So earthquakes happen all along this fault due to these movements. So they are an important natural disaster. We'll study about earthquakes in detail later, but for now we'll only study about behavior of seismic waves, which are important in helping us understand Earth's internal structure. So there are mainly two kinds of seismic waves. One are body waves and surface waves. And the body waves are primary waves and secondary waves. Surface waves are the waves which are generated mainly from primary and secondary waves. They are not the ones that originate at the focus. At the focus, there are only two waves that are formed. One is secondary wave and the other one is primary wave. We'll see about these waves. And the surface waves are the ones where the primary and secondary waves interacting with rocks generate surface waves. So surface waves are generated near the Earth's surface, and these waves are very destructive in nature because of greater amplitude and longer wavelength. We see from the below figure the intensity of each wave, each kind of waves, and the speed at which they arrive to the Earth's surface. The first ones to be observed at the surface during an earthquake event are the primary waves, followed by secondary waves, and the last to appear are the surface waves. But coming to amplitude and wavelength, primary and secondary waves are high frequency, low wavelength waves with little or small amplitudes, whereas surface waves are waves which have greater wavelengths, less frequency, and very great amplitude. So you must be knowing what is an amplitude, wavelength, etc. You know that when a wave propagates, usually it takes these curvy paths. This is called as wavelength, from one end to the complete curving path. So when this wavelength is greater, then the destruction is maximum. And when the frequency is greater, then this wave would appear like this, a very frequently curving paths, or this is called as wave period also, this length. And when we come to amplitude, it is just the distance from the center or the axis of the wave. So this is amplitude. When amplitude is greater, even then the intensity of earthquake will be greater. So in our understanding of Earth's interior, surface waves are not important because they are localized, or waves generated only at the surface. But primary and secondary waves are the waves which originate at the focus and spread or radiate in all directions. So these waves are important for our study. So let us first look at characteristics of these earthquake waves. First ones are primary waves. They are transverse in nature, longitudinal in nature, similar to sound waves. They are also called as compressional waves. And as I've already said, they are high frequency, long wavelength waves. And they are the fastest and first to arrive at the surface. And the most important property is they travel in all mediums, that is solids, liquids, and gases. This property is important. And coming to velocity, the velocity depends on shear strength or density of material. Usually there is a little difference between density and shear strength. Shear strength is nothing but elasticity. For example, if you take a glass of water and we suddenly remove or pour the water on the surface, the water will spread. This is because the shape of water in the tumbler is mainly due to the tumbler or glass. But when it is put on the surface, there is no shape that it takes. This is because of lesser shear strength or lesser density of water. Whereas if you take a block of iron, it will stay intact because of its greater shear strength. So The speed or velocity of these waves depend on shear strength. And there is one exception when we consider density. For example, mercury has greater density compared to iron, but speed of primary waves in mercury is much lesser compared to that in iron. This is because mercury is a liquid, it has lesser shear strength, whereas iron being solid has greater shear strength. So it is the shear strength or elasticity which is the basic reason that explains the increasing velocity with increasing toughness of material. So it is not density, but it's shear strength. And the next waves are called as secondary waves or S waves. They're also called as transverse waves, or we'll see this what is transverse and longitudinal or distortional waves. There are also high frequency and short wavelength waves. This is not long, short wavelength waves. This is also wrong. High frequency, short wavelength waves. And arrives after P waves, we have seen this. The most important property is cannot travel in liquids and gases. This is the most important property, and this will help immensely in understanding Earth's internal structure. We'll see that by seeing shadow zones. And surface waves are the waves which are called as localized waves. They are mainly produced due to interaction of primary waves and secondary waves with the rocks at the surface. They're also in transverse in nature, just like secondary waves. But these waves are low frequency and long wavelength waves. That is, their wavelength is so long, they can create huge disturbances on the Earth's surface. And the amplitudes is also greater. They're also called localized waves because they are present only at a small region around the epicenter. They are not seen elsewhere or at a longer distances. But the most important thing is they are the most destructive ones. So let us look at what is a transverse wave and a longitudinal wave.